So, we'll first start about like what's a high level about Aerospike, where does it fit in your use case, and we'll quickly dive into the architecture of Aerospike, why we think it is like superior compared to other NoSQL databases. So, why should you even consider Aerospike? So, this is not because like we think we are great, but like people have been giving us credibility. So this is the Gartner research, and they have a magic quadrant where they do analysis of softwares in a particular field. So this particular magic quadrant is about DBMS systems, all DBMS systems, SQL, NoSQL, everything put together. So the top half is about like proven guys, like who have proven beyond doubt. So if you see in the leaders, like you'll see IBM, Oracle, Microsoft, so who are proven beyond doubt. And if you see the lower left half, so you'll see a busy activity going there. So you can see all the popular names like MongoDB, Couchbase, Cassandra, all these guys trying to execute and trying to figure out what needs to be done. But if you see one lone dot there, which is representing Aerospike in the visionary quadrant, so who thinks that they got the equation of the future, right? So I think like that's a big credibility that we got from Gartner. Okay, so I just told you like where the world thinks we fit, and like now this is like what we think we fit in the world. Okay, so the top half is about your OLTP systems like your MySQL, which you are totally aware of, and the NoSQL databases which you use to serve data in real time, all the OLTP systems. And the lower half is about your analytics softwares. So the traditional analytics softwares are your Teradata or Vertica type of systems, and on the right hand side you have Hadoop systems. So in general, if you see, the left hand side is your monolithic single node systems. On the right hand side you'll see clustered solutions. Okay, so we think the Aerospike fits in the OLTP space, but we are slowly expanding into the analytics space because like in our newer version of the product we have aggregations which are similar to, which is a MapReduce kind of framework, not the traditional Google or Hadoop MapReduce framework, but we have our own MapReduce type of framework. Okay. So I'll quickly skip these slides because so in general, if you see what is big data, like so the way we tend to think about big data is like in three different categories. One is the volume, the other is variety, and the velocity of the data. So volume is like you keep collecting all the web hits or your mobile tracking data, all the information, and shove it into your data stores, and you analyze them in the long running jobs, right? Typically it is your logs, and where you run your Hadoop MapReduce jobs and extract meaningful information out of this raw data. Okay, and variety comes from different sources of the data. You have data coming from web, mobile, sensors, all these things. So and like all these different sources of data will have different types of representation of the data. Okay, so you have to transform into a unified way all the data, aggregate it and store it and use it later. And then comes to the velocity. So the beauty of velocity is whatever you collected through your volumes and like analyzing that, or the data coming from your variety of sources, you have to extract meaningful information and store it somewhere and use it, right? Without using it, all the data that you're collecting and analyzing is useless. And because you have a lot of data and like, you want to target a lot of people, so the systems which are serving velocity should be really, really fast. And that's where we have typical OLTP systems come into picture. And like that's where we think Aerospike fits. So this is like high-level stuff, like Aerospike is all flash optimized SSDs. So it's not that like now that SSDs are popular, Aerospike started supporting SSDs. It's 5 years back we decided that SSDs is going to the future, and like we never bothered about rotation file systems. Okay, so Aerospike can be configured in like three modes, like which is totally in memory or totally on SSD, or you can have a in memory plus rotation storage also. But we don't support part of the data in rotation space, but part of it in memory. We don't support that, and we think that's going to be stale. So this is throughput numbers. Like, you don't need to believe any of this now, because you're going to see yourself when you're trying Aerospike today. But just to quote it, so this is the YCSB benchmark, like where we achieved like 1.6 million TPS on a 4-node cluster in an in-memory configuration. And single node clusters, if you want to see, like we have blog posts talking how to reach 1 million TPS using Aerospike on a single node in-memory configuration again. And everybody thinks that like Amazon machines are slow, like you all are virtual machines, you cannot really extract very good performance from Amazon. So we broke those barriers also. We were able to reach very close to 1 million TPS, which is about like 960K TPS on Amazon machines. And the last phase of this talk, Anshu is going to talk about how to achieve that in Amazon machines. What are the choices you have to make on Amazon to get best performance on EC2 instances? All TCO stuff. So we'll quickly go into the architecture part. So probably this is most interesting for the geeks. Okay. So if I had to summarize the whole of beauty of Aerospike in one word, it is just the no hotspots in the whole system of Aerospike. So my challenge for you in the next 20-30 minutes is to find a hotspot in our system. There's no good answer, but let me encourage you to say that there are few answers which will come close. Okay. So what do I say? Like, why do I say that there are no hotspots? So if you see at different levels, we have made sure that there are no hotspots anywhere. So at a data distribution level, that means that sharding, where we don't do range sharding, which can typically cause hotspots. So there is a default sharding mechanism, auto sharding mechanism, which is hash based, which will avoid any hotspots. And like node-to-node communication, the intra-node communication, there's no hotspot. There's no special node in our cluster at all. Okay, so every node is same.
It's like the dynamo model.
Dynamo model, I'm not sure if they have a cluster manager, cluster principal, where all the for all the important decisions you go to the cluster manager, coordinator. Okay.
What is the hotspot?
Okay, sorry.
Bottleneck.
So. Sorry. Not necessarily failure. So let's say there's a cluster coordinator, and if that cluster coordinator fails, and immediately I choose a different coordinator, that's not a single point of failure per se, but it's definitely a hotspot, right? Same with node-to-client communication. So typically, if you see other NoSQL databases, like they have a configuration where, like you say, you talk to one node in the cluster, and that node will in turn talk to the other nodes in the cluster. We don't have that type. So okay, we'll talk in detail all these things. So internally within the software, at thread level, like again, all the load is distributed between all the worker threads that we have. In terms of exploiting the cores on the machine, like we do a very good job of balancing the load on all the cores of the machine. Same at network. I think like network is one of the least exploited by most people, because like you buy very expensive hardware, like with 32 cores or whatever, like you do a use a network card on motherboard. That's going to suck. Okay, so what you should invest is in network card which has multiple queues, where you can assign the interrupts coming from these multiple queues to the cores. So Aerospike has an afterburner script which realizes how many cores you have, how many network queues your network card has, and automatically distribute these network queues, assigns network queues to the cores so that interrupts coming them are evenly distributed across your cores. Okay? And SSD level, so we have our own file system, we don't use ext4 file system. You have an option, but we think that's not very fast. So we have our own file system, which does striping across hard disks, SSDs. So if you have multiple SSDs, you don't need to put them under a RAID controller to have good IO parallelism to do striping and things like that. Okay. Just before diving into the architecture, so if you see, like, when you scale, right, things start to fail. Like, and we have contingency plan, or like mitigation plan rather, how to handle these things, like speed, right? So every small bottleneck gets amplified when you're talking about scale. So maybe like when you're doing it like 10K TPS per second, probably these things are not so important. But But like when you're talking about 100,000, a million transactions per second, every small thing matters a lot. Okay, so you cannot ignore them, even the smallest bottlenecks. So machine starts to fail, right? Like if you have 100 node clusters, the probability of the failure of a node grows exponentially with the size of the clusters. So it will be a nice solution if the software or whatever system is using can do the same job in lesser number of clusters. So because of the vertical scaling that we have at Aerospike, so the same job can be done with a much lesser number of machines. So network starts to fail. So this is actually a hard problem. And Aerospike is a AP system. So what that means is if your network gets partitioned, it sacrifices consistency. And we fall back to eventually consistent model where if the network partitioning restores, we do a eventual consistency, we merge all the data back and make sure that it is consistent. So the load expectation, so like you think, okay, for me like 30k TPS per second is enough, but like suddenly like your app takes off and like suddenly you're at 1 million TPS, so expectations start to fail. So you should have a lot of headroom, and like we think Aerospike gives a lot of headroom. So operations is again like an underestimated thing. So if you have again like 100 node clusters, like somebody has to manage all these machines, right? So, and like typically they may make mistakes. All these automation tools like Puppet Chef makes this job easier, but like still mistakes happen. Some wrong configuration get pushed or whatever. So what Aerospike does is like it removes most of the configuration needs. So we do auto clustering. You don't need to set up something like this is my master, this is my slave. You don't need to say any of that. So to do a 4-node cluster, especially on bare metal machines which support multicast, to have a 4-node cluster, you just boot up 4 nodes. It will form a cluster on its own. And it will also have automatic assignment of master and role nodes. It will do auto sharding, so you don't need to say how to shard the data. You just can start doing reads and writes. And auto rebalancing, if like one node goes down in your cluster, you didn't need to wait for some manual operator to come and say, okay, now rebalance this data. So it automatically does rebalancing. So, and like, this is like very standard, nothing unique to Aerospike. So we pick the best default configurations, yet retain the ability to change them when needed. Okay. So quickly about the data model, this is very typical of any NoSQL databases. Like you have namespaces, which is analogous to databases. So database carries some properties like saying, where should this file, where should the data go, like which devices, which files it should go. Like is it in-memory configuration or is it on-disk configuration and things like that. And we have something called sets, which are similar to tables, just to have a logical organization of your data, nothing more than that. So you don't need to create them in advance, like you can just create them on the fly. Okay. So records will be like a key value pairs, but like the value part will have multiple bins. Where you can set the bins, read specific bins or read all the bins of the record and things like that. So the data types we support is like strings, integers, maps, lists, and we have something called LDTs. So that restriction on the record size is the write block size that you define. So in memory, we don't have a you don't need to define a write block size. So in memory, the limit is much higher, but when you use SSDs, what we have found with SSDs is like if it is around like 1 MB write block size, your SSD behavior is very good in terms of the IO, both reads and writes. So we recommend to people to go about 1 MB. So it becomes 1 MB becomes your record size restriction. So to break that barrier of 1 MB, we have something called LDTs, where we manage internally that one record spanning multiple blocks, and we absorb the complexity. So you just can say, you can think of it as Redis list. So you just keep adding to the list and just reading from the list. Okay.
So if a block size at a flash drive is 1 meg, what application does that on IO?
IO performance. So the number of the throughput kind of reduces. Does that answer your question?
I mean, so you're going to read block by block, right? or your records may be much smaller than.
Yeah. We don't trade the entire block, but we know the offset where we should start trading, and if your record is like much smaller, let's say 100 bytes, we pack a lot of records into this one block. So we know where to read from and how much to read.
So the block is not pushing you to read it in a
No.
Do you support counter?
Sorry?
Do you support counter style operation, increment, decrement?
Yes, operations we support. So we have increment, decrement, append, prepend, all these things. So any questions about the data model? I think, hope it's fine. So in terms of architecture, I kind of already mentioned that like we have all the nodes in the cluster are equal for us. Okay, so everybody will be a master for some of the data and the replica for some part of the data. I think we'll cover that in detail later. And like then the clients keep talking to the cluster, so they will discover the cluster and they will talk. So you just need to concentrate on your application logic. You don't need to do connection pooling, anything yourself. Our client layer will do that for you. Okay, and we have a cross data center product which will ship data from one data center to the other data center. So the replication within data center is synchronous replication. So unless the write was written in two places, in two nodes, we don't return an acknowledgement back to the client. But the cross data center geography replication which happens across WAN links, it is done in an asynchronous way. So this is the cross data center replication. So we try to put no restrictions on the configuration between the source data center and the destination data center. The only restriction that you have is that the both of them should have the same namespace, the name, database name, that's it. So let's say your source can be your in-memory configuration, your destination can be your on-disk configuration. So what you can, exploit this fact, like say you have temporal data, where all the writes coming, like you write to this, where you have an expiry period of, let's say, 7 days or 2 days, whatever you want. But you want to have more historical data on your other cluster. So you can use XDR to keep streaming all the writes to your more persistent cluster and use this for your temporal needs. So you can configure in multiple ways, like active-passive mode, active-active mode. You can have a chain, so A ships to B, B ships to C. You can have mesh modes like ABC shipping to each other parallelly, all the stuff. Okay.
Do you have a rack awareness?
Yes. Rack awareness comes in the single node, within the cluster. Yes, so we'll talk about rack awareness also. So I think like everybody keeps talking about disaster recovery, but like I don't know how many people actually faced it. We actually faced it in Aerospike. So during Superstorm Sandy, like this Excellence use case where they had a Superstorm Sandy in New York, so their data center was getting flooded and like they had half an hour to change everything. So they had this replication ring going on and like they just need to take out the New York data center out of it, and like they just short circuit the New York data center, so the rest of the three data centers they have just continued to work. Like we got a good quote from their CTO. Okay, we'll go a little deeper now. So how do we do auto sharding? I was talking about that. So every key that could possibly come in is already, let me step a little bit back. Okay, so we have partitions. Okay, so all the data will go into one of these 4096 partitions, which is hard coded in the product. So any key that comes is hashed using RIPEMD hashing. So RIPEMD hashing is one of the best hashing algorithms which is used in the security domain for least number of collisions. Okay, so any key coming into the database will be hashed into a 20 byte digest, we call it the digest, using this RIPEMD hashing. So based on the hash function, hash that is generated on the key, it will be assigned to one of these 4K partitions. Okay. So these partitions are kind of virtual, right? So they are not predefined or tightly bound to a node. So depending on the cluster size or the number of nodes in the cluster at that moment, we assign these partitions to one of these nodes. So if you see this whole sharding mechanism, one first level sharding is static sharding, you can say, because that's purely based on digest. And the next level of, sorry, I should not call the second level as a sharding, it's just a distribution. So we assign the partitions to nodes depending on the size of the cluster. And as a cluster size changes, we reorganize the partitions and we'll go into details of how we do that part. Okay?
But partitions are statically allocated?
Not static, that's what I'm saying. It's dynamic. We take care of that. So some, for every partition, there will be a master and a replica.
Right.
So who is the master, who will be the replica will be decided on the fly. That part is dynamic.
But once it has been decided,
yes,
it will stay for the...
It will stay like that. So unless the cluster state changes, it won't change.
And the cluster will change only when one of the nodes.
When a new
down.
Node is added or an existing node goes away. That's right.
So the master for different partition
may
be different.
Correct. So so in this 4K partitions, right? So let's say you have four nodes. Every node will be owner for or master for one of the 1,000 partitions. Right? So every node will be master for 1,000 partitions and every node will be replica for 1,000 partitions. More or less. Give or take like maybe a little bit imbalance. Of 5%, 10%.
But then this will still create non-balanced data.
If you say like a non-balanced amount of 5% to 10%, yes.
That's what it
is? Yeah. So our internal test cases has this test where you say like anything beyond 5% imbalance is not tolerated.
Right.
So the hashing is a trick here. So the RIPMD hashing is like one of the well-known, I was saying, right? To be most evenly distributed and least collisive, both.
Right. So this 4096 partition, is that configurable and
no.
Preceptable?
No. Unless we change in the product, like which is hard-coded, you cannot do that.
And this is irrelevant to the number of nodes you have in the
cluster. That's
right.
And why did you decide on this number?
We think like 4K is enough. Let's say like, if you have 4,000 nodes, then probably this is not a good number.
Mm-hmm.
But like with, we have internal again hard-coded number to 128 maximum cluster size. So if you have 128 nodes, this will be like 400 partitions each,
mm-hmm.
Right, roughly. Maybe. Okay, so I think like 100 partitions owned by one node and like having replica is not a bad number.
Yeah. And is this hash function, is that computable as well?
No. This is a standard hashing algorithm. You get it in public. So we'll go into clients. So I was telling like the clients are also intelligent. So so what you have to do like when you want to talk to a cluster is you just give one seed IP of the cluster. So the clients will figure out the rest of the cluster talk. Because the cluster keeps talking between themselves and they discover the full cluster. So they will communicate this information to the client and client knows, client will also ask, go to every node and ask who are you master for and who are you replica for. So if a request comes for a read or write for a particular key, it will know exactly which node to go to do this write or a read. So write always goes to the master, but read can go either to the master or the replica. Okay?
That becomes your single point.
Again, not hotspot because there are like 4,000 partitions, and this is evenly distributed. So, if you see, like the load will be very evenly distributed.
But who will take the request? So it's one client.
One client is typically a bad idea when you're talking about app servers layer and the database layer. So typically, you will have like 40-50 web servers running in front of like a 4-node cluster, right?
Sometimes the splitting of partition, like it is like 4K partitions, it's like starting from 1K and then it goes to 4K.
No. Predefined. Like the moment the cluster starts, this is 4K.
What if your partition grew, like one partition is 3GB and another partition is 3GB?
It cannot go because of the hash function. So hash function will evenly distribute all the keys in these 4K partitions. So out of this digest, we pick few of the bytes and then again hash it to one of these 4K partitions. So the hash function does all the trick of load balancing here.
So the hashing must be happening on one or two keys, or I mean, it could be a composite key or a single key.
One key, right? It's a key value store.
Right.
So every record will have a key and a value part. So the hash is based on the key.
On a key.
On a key.
Not on the composite.
Not on the composite.
So
that's a unique identifier for any record.
Means can I define that key?
Oh yeah.
I can define that key. So then you randomize that in a key so that it could be distributed evenly across all
Correct.
The partitions.
That's right. So we don't take your key as it is and assign a partition to that.
Okay.
That would be a bad idea because that would create imbalance.
So how do you ensure data correlation just in case there are certain sort of keys that are typically accessed together?
You shouldn't assume co-location, or you shouldn't plan in a way that these keys are co-located, so I will do something with this. You shouldn't do that.
So it could so happen that you have multiple key clusters, right? So you have one data set for which you have one set of key value pairs, and
okay.
then there is another data set that has a different set of key value pairs.
Yeah, so then you can organize into namespaces. So like you put everything into this namespace or like a different namespace, or like put it into sets, which are analogous to tables.
Mm-hmm.
So you should not plan your application to have data collocation across keys. That's your range sharding, which comes with its own problems.
But the bins are collocated.
Bins are always collocated, yes.
So you could, I mean, if that is the case, then you can choose a key which kind of occupies that input.
That's right. So we have this list, maps, LDTs, data types. So if you want something which needs very tight coupling, that's what you should do. Right? Thank you. Okay, so we're talking about client. So the client, you just need to give a seed IP. It will discover everything. It will discover master protocols. Directly send the read writes to the correct node. So it's a single hop from client to the cluster node. So again, like we give all these semantics, like you can generate a transaction ID from the client and say, for which I'm getting reply for doing an asynchronous client libraries. We have asynchronous client libraries, and we have auto retry logic in our clients. You can choose to disable that, so we have all those options. So SSDs like is one of the biggest strengths of Aerospike. I was saying like we have our own file system. We can bypass your file systems. But if you choose to use file system, you still have an option for that. So one important thing to note in Aerospike is that all our indices are in RAM, always. Irrespective of your data is in the disk or not, the index is always in the RAM. So why do we do that? Is to have very predictable latency. So if you have everything in RAM, like and the index trees are B-trees, like, the time taken for any key lookup is the same. Okay, so and after you do their index search, you directly go to the disk, you know the location of the disk and how much data you directly read it from the disk. Okay, so you may start thinking that like, okay, if my process crashes, all these indices are gone, so I have to rebuild my index, right? So we have a trick there. So we use something called shared memory. So if you have used shared memory, there's something called anonymous mode of setting up a shared memory, which doesn't need to have a process associated with the memory. So even if your process goes down, like maybe you are doing an upgrades or anything like that. So if the process goes down, like we, when you start the process again, we know exactly where to attach in the shared memory, and we directly attach, and we just quickly do a sanity check whether the entire cluster index is in sync with the data, just the basic checks, and say like we are ready. So what used to take like about half an hour before this particular feature now takes about 10 seconds to restart your process.
So your indexes are not replicated?
Every node will have its own index. So in a way, index is also replicated. Index is not persisted to a disk, if that's what you want to say. Yes.
And it is never persisted.
It's never persisted to disk. So in the event that the whole machine goes down, which is much more rare than a process going down, we rebuild the index. We have to rebuild the index. There is no shortcut there.
Can the index, you said the index is replicated? The index
there's no point, right? Anyway, you have to ship the whole record. So again, do the operation of a write.
Okay. You told about this index is a B-tree, right?
Sorry? Yeah.
So the index is a B-tree, right? So what if there is a lot of random deletes, right? So every day I get like 80 users and 20 users get deleted, 20% of the data gets deleted. What is the kind of optimization?
Yeah, so if you have to qualify more than arbitrary, it's a red-black tree. Sorry, I said BT, it's a red-black tree. So where it is a good data structure to support both a balance of reads, writes, and deletes. So if you do a writes, if you just do a take a fully balanced binary tree, and if the root node splits or root node has to merge, like you end up reorganizing a whole bunch of your data. But whereas the beauty of red-black tree is only you have a subtree of it just getting reorganized. So it's a very good data structure to balance reads, writes, and deletes. So you don't have like one bad phase where the entire tree is merging, like which takes like 1 second maybe. We never have that situation. Okay. So talking about SSDs, right? If you take any software, replace your rotation disk with SSDs, it will go very fast, no doubt about it. But if you do that, the software will very quickly burn your SSDs if it is not handling the SSDs in the right way. And we think like we handle the SSDs very properly because we never do in-place updates. So because writes can come at a very high rate. So if you go and update, keep updating a same block, it's not like your rotation disk where it writes exactly at the same block where the original data was. So what SSDs does is, so it will have its own blocks. Because it's like an EEPROM memory, it cannot update unless you erase the whole block. So what it does do, it has like 1K, 4K, whatever block size it has internally. Even if you update 100 bytes in that, it will create, it will copy whatever is there in this 1K block and modify your 100 bytes that you are trying to modify and write it into a new block. So you're very quickly going to burn your SSDs if the software is not aware of this. Okay, so we never ever do in-place updates. So what, sorry?
You only do append to logs.
Yeah, we have a log structured kind of file system where we read the original content and then do a buffered write in memory. So once we have this write block size, like which is configured maybe 1 MB, once this 1 MB block is full, we just write the whole thing into a disk. Okay? So because of this thing, like some you have to mark some of the old records as deleted, so it will keep generating some garbage or fragmentation. So we have a background job which keep running to clean up this garbage. So I already mentioned about this fast restart using shared memory. We never rebuild the index. The process has to restart. And I also covered saying that like you don't need to put this multiple SSDs or SSDs under a RAID controller to have striping. We do that ourselves. So if you attach four nodes, again, this is based on the digest. We choose which SSD it will go to, and we do the striping ourselves. So again, no hotspot even at SSD level. You don't need to put all the data into one SSD. So you can attach 10 SSDs to your box and say like, I want the namespace to use all these 10 SSDs. Okay, what we do is based on the hash, which is used for partition assignment, everything, the same hash function is used to decide which disk it will go to, this record will go to. So again, because of the even distribution of the hash, all the SSDs that are attached to this namespace are evenly used. So again, no hotspot at disk level also, is the point I'm trying to say.
So, so there are no in-place updates.
Yeah.
So in the RAM
update, doesn't write it immediately back. It will do a buffered write. All the writes that are happening at that period, it will be buffered. One MB block gets flushed to disk.
What happens if the machine goes down before the write?
Yeah, so what is the probability of a failure, right? So your concern is the durability. So the durability story of Aerospike is because you have synchronous replication. So the probability of losing a data which Aerospike says or the system says it is committed can only happen if two nodes goes down in the system exactly at the same time. So if at least one of the node flushes its memory to the disk, you are not going to lose that data. Right? Does that answer your question?
That means changes are happening.
Yeah, and we do synchronous replication. So unless it is written on the prol, you can, the server will not respond back to the client server that,
okay,
that the write is done.
Okay.
But if you choose to relax this consistency guarantee, maybe for performance requirements, you have an option to relax this.
Okay.
But by default, it's synchronous replication.
And that is on every operation level.
That's
like,
right.
Why you should not write consistency?
No. You have to. You have to set it at namespace
configuration.
Sorry, the entire server configuration.
Oh, enter.
That's right.
Something,
the in-place
update means to the SSD or?
In-place update is just a technique used by different softwares. So if you say like traditional.
Update to the SSD or?
Any device. It could be any device.
Not to the other replicas.
Yeah, so we don't do in-place updates. So there are some softwares where they think that it is rotational device, and so if you can directly go and update at the same location on the rotational device. We don't do that. Because if you do that, it will burn SSDs. Okay, so again, like I was saying, right, SSD is the like strength of Aerospike. It's not because like we know these techniques. We have a very exhaustive knowledge of what SSDs are good, what is not good, and like we have a certification tool which is also open source, which certifies the performance of SSDs. Okay, and like on our website, if you go to our website, like we have a recommended list of SSDs which qualify our ACT tool, like Aerospike certification tool. Again, like these are like proven SSDs, but like there are people like who say, okay, you may go with different SSDs for different cost reasons and all. So again, like a good story around this is when we were coming up with SSDs like 4 years, 5 years back, like these SSDs were not reliable and like they're just maturing at that stage. So like AppNexus, which is one of the biggest customer, has about like 100 nodes in deployment across 4 different clusters. Like they have 4 SSDs on each machine, and like they wanted to replace their entire set of SSDs on all the machines after a year, because at that time like SSDs are don't have much lifetime. So what they did, like they brought some new Intel SSDs and said, okay, we want to use these SSDs. Said, okay, let us try our ACT tool on them, and they didn't qualify. Okay, so we said like they will not run. So AppNexus cancelled like SSDs, like 400, order for 400 SSDs, and like at that time SSDs is about like $500. So that's like about $1-2 million order getting cancelled. So Intel, why are you cancelling this order? So this AppNexus said, because Aerospike didn't certify this. Intel was arrogant and said, what is Aerospike? So like they came to us and like we said, like, see the behavior of SSDs. So if you see the SSDs, right, like you have to run them like for a long duration. So when you just buy new SSDs, they have a lot of free space, and the defragmentation at the controller level works very nicely. Over time, it degrades. So after a day, like the performance going down will suddenly fall down. Okay. So we showed this to Intel, and like they realized that they had a bug in their firmware, and they upgraded the firmware, and like they gave the same SSD again with a fixed firmware. So now they've passed, and like if we went ahead. So every time Intel releases a new SSD, they give us free SSDs now. So same with Samsung, OCC, all these guys now. Okay, already covered briefly. So self-configuring clusters, there are two modes in which you can form clusters. One is a multicast mode, where to start a 4-node cluster, you just boot up 4 nodes. The IP, multicast IP is specified. They discuss on this multicast IP, discover each other, form a cluster. Yes. You don't need to do any of this. Again, master node assignment. So typically, this is a blocking phase, and like which lasts for about like 100 milliseconds. Okay, we cannot take reads and the writes during this period, because the master and role ownership is changing at this moment. So the writes which are already initiated may fail, and it can be retried, and they'll succeed after 100 milliseconds. So what happens during when you are adding
the, during the rebalancing phase?
No, this is only when deciding the new master and replica nodes. And the rebalancing can go for a long duration where the data gets migrated from the old master to the new master or a new replica. Okay, during this phase we accept reads and writes. Because we know
the read and write performance impacted by the rebalancing.
It does impact because first of all there's a lot of network traffic going around and it's equivalent to doing the same amount of writes on those nodes where you are shipping the data to the new masters and new replicas. So it does take an impact during that period. Again, there are tunables where you can say like at which speed you want to do the replication, how many threads you want to do, and like you can tune all of this depending on how much hit you can take. Okay. So the important point is like while during this whole rebalancing, we continue to take reads and writes. So, sorry, was there a question? Okay. Yeah. So all the writes that are happening during this rebalancing will be journal so that the migrating data and the writes, the new writes that are coming are not lost. So once we migrate all the data, we make sure, go through the journal and make sure all the writes are in the partition. Okay.
So is your cluster management protocol homegrown or using
JDO? It is homegrown, but based on a standard Paxos algorithm. It is homegrown. We wrote it ourselves. We don't use anything. Not it's okay. We don't even believe in other file systems, so we wrote our own. I think like, yeah. So consistency during writes, I think again I already covered. All the data gets synchronously written to the replica. You can relax this if you want. All buffered writes queuing to the disk, all that standard stuff. Okay. So we have second indices, which are built synchronously again, not like some other softwares which will asynchronously build these second indices or views. Okay. So again, what's the point? Second indices are pretty standard, right? So you want to get all the records, all the information about people like living in city Bangalore. So you can create a second index on your bin of city. So so we make sure that we update these SNSS in a consistent way. So we preserve the asset properties during that period. Okay. So how do you query the SNSS? Again, because we distribute the primary keys evenly across all the nodes, so for every second index query that is coming in, again the second index query has to go to all the nodes. So it is kind of a map reduce, but you don't need to write any logic for that. So it goes to every node, execute this query, all the nodes pump the data to the client back. Okay, so all of this happens in parallel. Same with aggregations. Aggregation is giving this MapReduce framework to you. So you can say like, I want, so if you want to run more complex queries, right? So let's say you want to aggregate the average age of people in Bangalore, but with some other clauses. So you can write any complex logic that you want in the MapReduce framework. So what happens is like once you trigger this job, the map and reduce phases happens at every node. So once the reduce phases happen at every node, the result is pumped to the client, which triggered this aggregation job, and the final reduction happens at the client, which triggered this. Okay. So the map reduce job is written in Lua. So these are like something in internals, like thread model. We follow asynchronous model internally, so we pass the workload from one set of threads to the other set of threads and make sure that one thread is not overloaded. So again, we use the same digest function to distribute the load to one of the worker threads and get the job done. Again, like thread core pinning to make sure that
the threads don't keep jumping from one core to other core, from one socket to the other socket, and things like that. Handling the network, I already covered. So our afterburner scripts takes care of assigning queues to the cores, all the interrupt handling, CPU handling, all cache friendliness, L1, L2. All our indices are 64 bytes, so that like it is very L2 cache friendly. I'm not sure about that one, but definitely L2 cache friendly. Again, like better kernels, all that stuff. That's the theory part. Any questions on the theory
architecture? What do you use for serialization,
data serialization? So we use message band. For lists and mass. For strings and integers, it's no serialization.
So how do you handle the logs? Is it at the record level or the granular level?
Yeah, that's at the record level. And if you talk in terms of ACID, we give a committed read isolation level.
Okay, I'm sorry.
He's asking like, what is the locking semantics? Is it at record level? Yeah, it is at record level. And if you talk in terms of ACID, we give read committed isolation. So you cannot read data which is changing.
But if your transaction is spanning across records, then?
Yeah, we don't have multi-record transactions at the moment. All the key value interactions are like single record.
Yeah.
So the transaction starts internally and ends internally.
Yeah.
We don't give the control to the amplifier.
Since this is so much hardware dependent, SSD and everything, so if we have to offer it as a virtualized mode, is there a virtualized mode here?
So the whole rest of the today, we'll be working on virtual mode, and you'll see that's not really the case. Because you can run in memory mode, which doesn't have any specific hardware needs.
So behind the scenes, there are SSDs which are pumping.
SSD is optional. So you can run, set your namespaces in purely in memory mode. You can also say like, I want my data in memory, but I want to store on a rotation device for persistence. And it's like continuous persistence, not like snapshot.
And besides, even on EC2,
Yeah, EBS latencies, if you see, like they are not guaranteed, and like the direct attached rotational devices will give you an average of 5 millisecond latencies, but EBS will give you like anywhere from 10 to 40 millisecond latencies. So can't really depend, but we are getting our story around EBS, so that's some story in making there for Aerospike.
Does it support join
queries? No. This is not like your traditional SQL databases where you can join, but like if what people use, what they do is like, they have these tables sitting in memory at the client layer. So what they can do is like you can run your second index, build this table, and then run one more second index, and you do the join yourself. So the database as such doesn't give that, but there are people who are already doing these joins at client level.
So the builds, do they have some sort or something
that implicit? No, bins don't have a specific sort.
So just understand, so you have the values essentially should be
bins. Yeah, but it's a set of columns, right? You can equate it to a set of columns.
Yes.
See how, and like this is flex schema, like typical with any. So you can say like my record has only 3 bins, but this record has many more bins. Like you can do any of that stuff.
Okay.
So nothing is predefined, flex schema.
Okay. And the bin again has a key and a
bin? No. It's key and bins. So you can,
like 5 bins.
Yeah, the client API, you can say, I want all bins of this record. Okay. Or you can say, I want like bin 1, bin 2, bin 3.
Okay.
So it will go fetch on. Sorry?
I can look up based on index. So I can
just the bin names.
Bin
names.
Oh, that's what I asked. So that again has further access to the key.
Yeah, you can think of it that way.
Okay.
Let's not call it key because we'll confuse with other key.
Okay.
Yeah, just bin names. Yeah. So like if you use Java client, right? So it will be automatically mapped to a Java map where you can simply say like from this map, give me bin 1. So.
And how is that structure again? The bin names are again. So I'm looking at the
storage layer. Yeah, so for the time series thing, right, like which may typically go beyond the typical record block size, we should be using LDTs where you can keep appending like beyond the write block size.
Okay.
And like for that, there is an API for list data types. We call it LList, large list, where you can say, I want the record from like this offset to this. So from 50, next 20. Second.
At the beginning you mentioned there can be some like near hotspot things that we could ask about.
Good that nobody came with that. So yeah, I think like
you think that the controller itself for the SSD could become a hotspot, because as of now,
yeah,
most of the industry the SSDs are SATA based. And
yeah,
of late, new grids of SSDs are PCIe based.
PCIe
contract. So the controller needs to be changed because the controller itself becomes a bottleneck there.
Yeah. Again, right, all these controllers now has like 32 queues at the controller level. So controllers are also becoming smart.
Mm-hmm.
But if you want to overcome that bottleneck, you can always add multiple SSDs, right?
Yeah.
So instead of buying like 1 terabyte SSD, buy like 4 of 200 GB SSDs.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
So that's like workaround.
Currently, you don't support the new breed of.
Oh, PCIe you can attach. And like you can say like. Linux file system, right? A raw file system will abstract out this for us.
Okay.
So you don't need to directly get access as a PCIe device.
Okay.
We don't do that. We access it as a raw device. So coming to the hotspot, like what could be a possible hotspot is like if there is a SKU in your application, right? So the YCSP benchmark that I was mentioning, so it generates a Zipfion distribution. So what that means is like 50% of the read-write requests come to one key. And like 25% will go to two keys. Next 12% will go to four keys. So the load is like very skewed, which is not a good, so at your application level also you should try to solve that. So I mean, for that kind of use case, I don't think there can be any database which does like just two levels or three levels of replication can solve that problem. So if you have like 10-way replica, all these requests coming can be distributed on these 10 replicas that you have. But again, it's a trade-off between that and whether you can maintain 10 replicas synchronously. So probably that's the closest answer that comes to a hotspot.
What's your P language?
So we have clients in almost all popular languages like C, Java, C Sharp.
So
real-time
queries,
what do you
use for real-time queries?
Again, I think like, yeah, so if you ask the recommendation from our side, so any event-driven models are pretty good. So they are very nice on the CPU.
No, so for RDB in SQL, you can go and cut the contents,
yeah,
of the collection.
So we don't have a SQL ourselves, so all the API is, all the query mechanism is API based. So we have the query, client API in different languages. So today we'll go on the Node.js how to query. So you can see the same pattern in all the languages that we support. So at the application level, the operations are simply connect, get, put, delete, second index query, all that stuff. That's it. So all of that will come with APIs. And we are in the process of probably coming up with some SQL. We don't have our own SQL yet. But we have a SQL-like thing in AQL, which we'll show. So for like operation.
What are the main people using
Aerospike,
right?
I skipped that slide because you may hate marketing. Okay, so and different verticals, like in mobile vertical, web advertising. So web advertising is like one of the strongest domain for Aerospike because these are the guys who started having scale problems now. Okay, every other industry is waking up to that. So mobile and web advertising is the having the most scale problem because they want to track everybody in the world. Everybody's visiting any website in the world. So like you can imagine the scale at which they operate, right? So so then marketing, search, retail space, like for product listing. And if you want to talk about Indian customers, like movie, cosmetics, Snap, Elcom, and Digiri. Okay, indirectly a lot of big companies use us because Oracle bought responses and
Lookai.
So Oracle is our customer, if you want me to say that. And Twitter is our customer because they bought
Mopub.
So if you see this slide, right, one interesting thing is like Google occupies probably the top spot in the web traffic and advertising world. So if you leave out Google, like 9 out of the top 15 companies who have this advertising are powered by Aerospike. Did you read a blog from Google? Sorry?
No, there was one slide.
Oh, you want to see the numbers?
But I couldn't, yeah, I couldn't see from here.
Yeah, while I'm moving the slides, you might have seen a recent blog from Google Compute Engine where Cassandra achieved 1 million transactions per second using 330 nodes. We can do it with probably 3 nodes. Okay. Yeah, so this is the graph, like, so this is Aerospike, which was like probably 2 years back. This is 2.0, this is 3.0, now that's the default. And like this is Cassandra, Mongo, Couch. And so the again, the important point is not just about throughput, it's the latency.
Yes.
So if you see the latency is that is like all the way up to 200,000 transactions per second, it's like under 1 millisecond. Like where you see as the throughput goes up, their latency keeps increasing.
Yes.
This is like different.
But that is the right.
This is update latency.
That's update. This test is performed by you guys or something?
This is YCSB benchmark.
Oh.
Done by Thumbtack. Yeah, sorry, Thumbtack.
Yeah, I mean Cassandra is really bad.
So, any other questions?
So you said 9 out of 15 people other than
Google.
Google. What are the other systems?
I don't know.
That's it.
Yeah. Sorry, Srini is our co-founder.
Sorry. Yeah. Well, to answer your question, others actually started before we existed. For example, Tern built their own. Rocket Fuel has something which they patched together with a bunch of stuff. So they all built their own systems. Just like Google did.
Basically competing against in-house solutions.
Yeah, and that's and some of them have been switching to us. Most recently, two of the top ones switching. We hope to get all of them. So.
Is this like the difference between Cassandra and like the one that he said is like huge? Like he said, they use 330 nodes for what you can do in 3 nodes.
Yeah.
That is very difficult to believe. How can like how can you have so much more efficiency over them?
Because that is their spec.
No, they have to.
So that's why I don't believe these numbers. You'll see it today. We'll show it live.
I mean, I'm sure they're not so dumb that.
No. Okay. You said something like this triggered something. I'm sorry. I have to. Is it okay?
Yeah. Sure.
They're not dumb at all. Let's be very clear. It's very possible that they are smarter than you know the people in Aerospike. That's not why we are better. We are better because our philosophy, what we have done is we've taken the speed of hardware as it goes down. We have taken our system, rewritten the database. You know, I'm a database person who's worked on IBM and so on 25 years ago with a PhD in databases. And I know how those systems are written. They're written for optimizing a rotational disk. You know, the example I have is, a rotational disk is like, you know, we're sitting in Bangalore, rotational disk is in California. Main memory, well, with Bangalore traffic, is like 10 meters away or something. So it's close, okay? SSDs are maybe like half a mile away. 1 kilometer or 2 kilometers away. When SSDs came in, everybody slaps an SSD, and Sunil mentioned that. You slap an SSD on an Oracle, it'll go 5 times faster. We will go 100 times faster. Not because we went and compared ourselves with Oracle, because we took SSDs, and what Sunil pointed out, we rewrote the database, data storage system. That's number one, that's the SSD base. In memory, there is multi-core. You know, I don't know how many of you are database experts, but you must have seen, some of you at least must have seen Postgres, you know, the inventor of Postgres, right? Like Mike Stonebreaker's paper in like 2005, 2006. He said like, it's time to rewrite the database because all the old stuff, it just doesn't work anymore because hardware has changed so much. There is more main memory, it's more multi-core. So that's the other aspect of things that Aerospike did. So we rewrote the entire database from scratch in C as fast as we could go against the hardware that existed today. They can't even compete. How can you? You use Java. Come on, man. I mean, it just goes to lunch every time you do garbage collection. We're talking about 1 millisecond. 1 millisecond is not even in the, you know, Java doesn't do anything 1 millisecond. It just sits there. And that's nothing to do with it. You use it for applications. I'm a Java programmer myself. Don't use it for systems which are real time. And that's the philosophical thing. And anybody can do what we did. It will just take you 4 or 5 years, and smart people like Sunil and others and Raj, the other guy sitting there, who got the 1 million transactions per second for us on Amazon, if you're around sometime soon. But the point is, you just work on it, okay? We worked on the hard problems, and these are the results to show, and that's why we're making it open source. And now you guys judge.
Have you done any comparison with HANA?
HANA is a SQL-based system, so probably it's not a good comparison for to do single key lookups with a key value store versus single key lookups in a HANA.
But
they're like, it's more of joins and all that stuff.
But the thing is the same, that, you know.
Try doing updates in HANA and do a query and come back and tell me what happens. That's the difference. We are a read-write system. You can do queries in Aerospike, and you can back up on Aerospike. It will run with high throughput reads and writes. HANA is used for typically analyzing, what are they called? You know, when you go to a store, you have a transaction, it's a on cash registers, right? Internet is an order of magnitude, two orders of magnitude bigger than cash register transactions throughout the world, okay? And that's what Aerospike runs against. HANA runs in that, you stick everything in memory, it is still enterprise-based. And it's, I think that's the whole bunch of things in memory. I have no, you know, truth is, they are solving a problem at a certain scale where there are not that many updates. So it works. And not having updates, the problem is actually an order of magnitude easier, frankly, you can think about it. If you don't have updates, it's actually an easy problem. And if you have updates, it's a harder problem. And that's one of the things to think about.
Yeah, if I may add, right, I was working with
Come here. So that is Raj again.
Okay, so I was working with Sideways these days, was acquired by SAP, right? HANA, I looked at HANA architecture. HANA still have a problem that, there are two problems. First problem is that entirely in memory, okay? So what it means is when you're running real HANA system in your application and all, your cost of power is more than your license cost of HANA itself. So the amount of RAM that these guys need is humongous. Secondly, they still cannot take updates at the pace they would want to. So what they have is they have two stores. One is the store which talks about only the update part, and the only the part which another part which only talks about the taking the live reads and writes. And the system they work on is more like ERP and CRM system, which is mostly manual driven. They're not still not got to a point where they can do Internet of Things, where they're actually tracking a whole you know, trucks and all the equipments and all at that level. And they are rewriting the stuff for SSDs anyway, so. I mean, they are still growing, they are learning about the stuff. So, to compare, we are a little bit ahead in terms of technology, in terms of SSDs. And of course, they are smart people, so they do really good stuff on memory, but they are solving this pretty difficult problem in terms of a lot of, NoSQL stuff doesn't do everything which relational does. They have a hard problem to solve, and they are trying to solve it. And they solve it pretty well, but they have their own set of problems. Like, you cannot just run it. Like, people like us or startups cannot run it at all. Like, you will cost $1 billion in a bill of electricity. It's not something you can afford, right? So, just some addition on this one.
So you talked about in-memory systems and memory hierarchy. So, just curious if you can, do you recommend using maybe Aerospike as a cache as well?
Sorry.
Yeah, so, do you recommend using maybe Aerospike as a cache?
There are customers.
I mean, are the customers using this cache?
Yes. So they do use a cache again, right? I didn't concentrate on much on one slide. So if your data size is too big, right? So instead of having, let's say, 20 machines with like 100 RAM each, you can put that whole thing in like 3-node cluster with an SSD. So it finally boils down to cost. The case study, like which I skipped, is like where we replace 192 in-memory machines with 18 Aerospike machines with SSD. So we could store the same amount of data in like much, much smaller memory, smaller number of machines. So because like machines, right, you have to consider a lot of cost, like power cost, maintenance cost, all these things. So like we could do the same thing, sorry, not the same thing, with 10x, the throughput with 10x lesser cost. The end-to-end cost.
Basically, from what I understood, you also basically you have taken huge advantage of the fact that one, the cost of SSD is falling really fast, and the access latency is much closer to main memory.
That's exactly right.
So probably I would probably use it like a cache in between.
Exactly.
But then because if the cost is dropping, the cache becomes like a few fulfilled data.
Right. That's right. That's exactly right. So we'll take
similar piece are there with BigSQL before?
I'm not aware of BigSQL.
BigSQL.
Anybody know about BigSQL? I don't know. So.
You know about slow SQL? I've written it myself.
So can you use parts of your system like piecemeal, like maybe just the file system layer itself?
If you want to store in a file system, you can do that as well.
No, but like your file system, because it's optimized for flash. I mean, because I'm guessing you also taken into consideration the wear and tear of the SSD. Flash has different write performance characteristics compared to rotational disk.
Okay.
So
I didn't get your question completely.
He's asking if he can just take your file system part.
Okay.
And use it for entirely different thing.
That should be
just
possible.
Let me
give a story behind that. So there's one company called Fusion.io, where we actually ran the entire Aerospike as a disk controller in the drives.
Yeah, that's exactly right.
So because,
like, for example, like I think Linux has ButterFS.
Razer. You're not talking about Razer.
No, not Razer. Is predominantly for rotational disk, but I don't remember the name. There are certain file systems that Linux supports, open source, which are there specially designed for Flash. So I just wanted to know if I can use that, or how does it compare? Do you have any performance benchmarks?
Just the storage level. We don't have that. But like Srini was saying, right, we are open source now. You can strip it out. But if you make any fun.
No, but is it like tightly coupled? Then it might be hard.
It's not that. It's not too tightly coupled because we have to support multiple storage models. Like we have a clean interface saying that I want to store this record. So the in the code, right? If you see the transaction layer says I want to write this record to disk. So internally it's like a overloaded function which will either go to memory or SSD or a KVS store. So probably you can strip out that layer and put your storage logic above that, or commit logic, whatever it is. So I think it should be possible. So because our storage layer is separate, because we have to support different types of storage, we wrote that with a clean interface.
Just let me know if I'm doing offline, but about the file system, do you have any optimization, for example, on the file system, for example, Riser?
Pure file system, you're asking? The standard file systems, not raw file system, you're asking, right?
Your file system, I'm saying, on flash.
Okay.
Does it have any optimization? For example, RiserFS, I know, does a lot of optimization for small files, right? It does tail packing, that's what it's called.
Okay.
A lot of
small things are clubbed into single
together. Do you have any such optimization?
We kind of do that because I was answering, I think, his question where if my record is like just 100 bytes, my write block size is like 1 MB. What do? So I shove in all the records into one block and write the whole block. And when I update, I just read that, say that, mark that this is deleted and write to a different location. So we have that optimization, but that optimizations are tuned specific to key value store needs.
Because even you have the same kind of chunk and block size optimization that you have to use for even distributed file system records, right?
Yeah.
We can face pretty much similar problem. How do you choose? Because if you choose a really small chunk size, then basically you store a lot of metadata for like a large file. So I just wanted to know whether it's like tunable or an optimization.
Yeah, so I think like if you're talking about Hadoop chunk size and all, like those chunks has to remember where are the replicas at the chunk level.
Yeah, so
we don't have those needs.
Yeah, you don't have those needs, but I'm just as an example for chunk size. You have to think about those things. If the chunk size is really large and you are not doing any packing in that, then you're actually losing a lot of down space. Right? But if you make chunk size really small, then again you have the other end of the spectrum where you have a lot of metadata about each. Like
that is true. So again, like our metadata is just a bitmap of all these blocks that we have and say how much amount of it is free. That's it. So we don't have those needs. So it is kind of tailored to our needs, but I don't see a reason why you cannot extend it.
Do you have any references from financial services industry?
Oh, we have all pamphlets. I don't want to distribute in a Geek conference. But okay, so tomorrow if you are coming to the conference, yes, we have all the collateral to distribute. Yes.
Do you also cater to hybrid workloads, as in both transactional and warehousing together?
Like I was saying, right? Our core strength 1 year back was like pure OLTP.
Mm-hmm.
Now we are moving into analytics space where we have our own MapReduce framework, which you can write your MapReduce jobs. So we are slowly stepping into analytics space. Yes.
Okay.
So we are already there.
And have you done any comparisons with some of the in-memory data grids like NPMSpan or Jumpfire?
But like we compared with all the traditional NoSQL databases. Okay.
Just to add, what other companies are using it, like Microsoft or other ones. So I little know that what other companies are using. Just wanted to add to that. So Rocket Fuel is one of the companies, okay, very good company. It is using Edgebase and they have written something which is very much optimized for that, right? So the kind of problem that you face is that you get a lot of deletes, a lot of random reads, right? That is where you get a problem. When you do sequential inserts, you really don't get a problem with rotational drives either. Right? And everything has to be in memory, right? And at the same point in time, but you need a persistent code.
Mm.
There's a lot of optimization that you actually do. Some things could be actually done on the application layer, something could be done in the somewhere around. You do a partitioning scheme, then you do a pre-partitioning, and then you make sure that your partition doesn't mean split, like you did in hashing and other things. So these are some of the areas which like companies have overall figured it out when they actually started using when companies like Aerospike was wanted and they built something on top of that. And suddenly it works, that is not that it doesn't work. It works. But you have to do like go over it 2 years to understand how the NoSQL system actually works. Right? So it can fit your model like MongoDB, Edgebase. These can actually fit, but you would take around 2 years, go through a lot of engineering work.
Customize for your needs.
Customize it, right? And here you go. So MongoDB, let's not go there because no transactions. I mean,
thank you. So we'll take a quick 10-minute break and then we'll get started, like hands on with the respect.
Nothing but the best for us.
Nitin, he wants to do
Where?
He asked for suggestions. I said nothing but the best, right?
So here, what do you have?
Log into the ACT instances. We'll log into the, so each one of you will get one machine. So we'll log into that ACT instance.
Okay.
Yeah, I'll share this collab edit. I think everybody should open this collab edit. Yeah, let everybody come. Okay, whoever is there, like in class. So collabedit.com/GQYXD. GQXYD. XYT. So everybody who's already here, can you open this URL? collabedit.com/GQXYT. So whatever I'm typing, I'll put it in this page and everybody can just copy paste the commands. GQXYT. Let me try to. Is it better now? This one. collabedit.com/GQXYT. No, just view this
document.
So
we open the web page and
yeah.
What to do
after that? I'll let you. So see, everybody seeing this page, right? The commands are here. This programming language, I think like I'm not getting a choice to move it out. But anyway, I think like once you start seeing that page, you don't really need the screen. This is only to share my comments with you.
Someone is editing the file.
Please don't.
This
is a general one. People use it. You can use the chat box if you want to make fun. I hope everybody is on. You are doing the first bit.ly one or PM file?
So when you entered this, this small snip was distributed with an IP.
Yeah.
So, okay. So this will be your reset instance.
Some was dedicated.
Yeah, I think like we have more, so don't worry, we have 100 of them. Yes, you'll be logging in again. Yeah.
Why are the web or?
First, you need to download this PM file to log into Amazon. So I'll just show you the command. So the PM URL is a secret key. So pick this URL and say like curl h. Maybe I should let me copy paste this. Somebody is hacking this. Yeah, so there's a curl command. Just copy paste the curl command. You'll get the PM file.
Where do you copy paste
it? Into your shell. So if you run the command, it will copy into a shell file.
So then some people are using Windows. They may not have curl installed or something like that.
Oh. Yeah, yeah.
You don't have any
virtual machine? I am on Linux.
Yeah. Is somebody purely on Windows?
We have virtual machines. We
yeah, but, to run yeah, yeah. So we'll just SSH there. That's all we need to do. Patel can use the PM file. We can supply the PM file. So if somebody used only Windows and know how to log into EC2 using PM file should help. EC2 user. So once you download the PM file, so you just have to do this command login. Use your IP here.
Switch on the mic.
Sorry, is it fine now?
The public key is the second step or is it third step?
So once you download the private key,
yeah.
So you just do SH minus.
No, but can you just start
from
step
one?
Yeah,
this is
the one. So
permission granted.
Yeah, just a second. So you need to do this first. Chmod, so it should be read only.
Yeah.
So once you have to the EC2 user and your IP. The IP that was given on your slip.
No
root
to source.
Can you help him? He's not able to download the command. You have to change the change mode, so you have to do chmod on the PM file. 400, only 400 will work. Can you help people if somebody is stuck? If anybody is stuck, like, please call our folks, can you? Yeah, if you have a shell, virtual machine, if you have.
Okay.
Yeah, you have to download your change mode and then log in using this.
It says permission denied within bracket, it says public.
Yeah, actually, I don't
did you have CH mode?
So, 400 is not
Yeah,
I've
done
CFD. So this is an error that I got if I didn't change unprotected key.
No, I mean, that's not the error.
How do you pass VM to a
button?
Putting in someone else's protection. So, you have to use the IP address?
Yes.
Instead of IP.
Yeah, you have to use the IP that is given in the license. I think some people are using the second 12 comments, so don't use that. Use this one first. This will get your private key. Is this clear now? Step 1, step 2, step 3. Just run those commands. Replace the IP with.
Can you paste back the bit.ly link as for the
do it from command line?
This is the
I mean just in case I have to type.
It is getting redirected, so let's
yeah, that's the wget will work.
So how many people are in the ECT instance? About you, ECT instance, are you able to log in?
Does anybody know how to use the PM file with booting? I think some people are purely Windows.
Sorry? Yeah, I think that's the same question, so I'm not sure answering.
Public key.
It's private key.
Okay, I think we'll proceed. So people who are stuck with Windows and QWERTY, sorry, I don't know how to use the PM file.
Just
see your neighbor doing it. Sorry. Okay.
Download that.
So once you do this, like we are going, so Aerospike has a Aerospike monitoring console, we call it AMC. So you can see different statistics on the server that is running on that machine on the entire cluster. So we'll first start the Aerospike server and see like what's the values in AMC and stuff like that. So we'll also generate load and see like what TPS you are able to get on those boxes. Okay, so remember that like right now you the boxes are like raw, which is not tuned. So I was, Anshu is going to talk about how to tune them to get even better performance on the same boxes. Okay. So once you're on that, so there is a. Oh, somebody posted a URL to use Protean with PM file. So please do that. So you have to know what is your public IP. What is the public IP of this box that you are logged into? So you have to run the curl command to get the public IP of the EC2 instance that you have. So everybody will have their own public IP. You will see this. So my public IP is like 54.210. Oh, okay. Actually, the slip that you have is your public IP. I was dumb. Sorry. Okay. So the okay. So the EM instances that you have already have Aerospike installed, the latest Aerospike installed in this AMIs, and it also has the ANC software. It also has a load generation software we'll use to generate load. Okay. So before starting, let's see how the configuration looks like.
Can you change the profile on the item? Like background should be hard to be.
But he did
it like this.
Background to white and foreground to
light background, yeah. Did it change? Is this better?
Yeah.
Is it better now? Okay. So you just have to do sudo. We want to see the configuration file. Aerospike.com. So just if you want to see the conf file, so the service section is something which is applicable across the node, across the namespaces. So you'll have a service section where it defines like user group which should run, PID file, number of threads, transaction rules, etc. and then like where you want the error log file to go, the logging section tells that. So the network section, we will touch on this. So network section tells like how to form the cluster. So EC2 doesn't allow multicast in its network. So what we have to do is fall back to the mesh model where you can set up the cluster node explicitly. It's only if you are doing everything hands-on. So the one workaround we have is we have something called cloud formation scripts. I'll quickly demo that later, where you just don't need to do any of these steps. You just use cloud formation script, say that this is the size of the cluster that I want. It will spin up all the instances, edit the config file accordingly to create the mesh, and it will form the cluster. Okay. So this is how the network is configured. So if you have multicast, right? So the last few active lines will not be there. It will be just three lines, mode multicast, address, the multicast address that you want to use, and the port. Okay?
Quick check, are there still people who haven't logged into EC2?
Yes.
So I've just added two more lines to the collab edit. That's a username password. You can log into that machine, and from that machine you can just log directly.
That's nice.
So that's username password, only thing.
So then this is the namespace configuration. Right now we didn't configure disks. So there's one namespace configured, test namespace, which says replication factor is 2. Of course not applicable for single node. So the memory size is like 54 gig configured. Default TTL is TTL expiry for all the records, which can be overridden from the clients. So the default is 30 days configured here, which simply says that, and also it says storage engine is memory. That's all the configuration you need to get started. And this comes by default when you install the Aerospike. You don't even need to write this file. Okay. So you just do sudo etc init.d Aerospike start. So just sudo etc init d Aerospike start. It should say okay. So how do you check from terminal that your server is really up and running? So you can do asinfo-v build. Right? It will tell the current build version it is running. The instance is always so it took some time to start.
Okay.
So simply do asinfo minus v build. So it should respond. That means your server is up. Okay. Just to give a quick peek, what all stats can be seen. So some people ask like, how do I know the health of the cluster? If you simply do AS-V stats, it dumps like whole bunch of stats. You don't need to go through all of them, but just to know. Okay, so now you have the public IP. So what you have to do is, before that. We started the Aerospike instance. Right. ETC init Aerospike start. Now we should start the ANC instance, Aerospike Monitoring Console. Okay, ANC started. So now you can go to your browser, give your IP. And go to port number 8081. Okay, 8081 is where your AMC is running. It will ask to give a seed IP of the cluster. Right now, just say instead of init Aerospike start, AMC start. Init AMC start.
Number?
8081. Go to in your browser, open the public IP, colon 8081. It will ask a seed IP of the cluster. So you can simply say 127.127.0.0.1. Say connect. Right. So like all the stats that we showed like is like presented nicely. It gives different statistics like what is the cluster disk size configured. So our node currently don't have disk, that's why it shows 0 bytes. RAM 54 bytes, 54 GB configured but 0 used. And then the number of nodes in the cluster, total namespaces, the build number, any alerts, read-write throughputs for the last 30 minutes. And we have the number of nodes, currently it's single node. Then we have the namespace configuration and then XDR. Okay. Port number 8081 is not there. What is XDR? XDR is a cross data center replication I talked about. You can say 127.0.0 or simply log. There's a URL in the collab edit how to do that. Can you help me? This is a local host. This is not the public IP. Yeah. So when the browser asks for you, you simply give the private IP which is local IP 127.0.0.1. You don't need to, you are already, that's just for your public IP, so you can skip and just use the one in your sleep, in your browser. HTTP, that's not HTTP. Sorry? You want to see the terminal? Okay, so we will simply insert like one, just to test, right? We will insert one record. So we have a very basic utility called CLI. For basic things, you can say CLI minus O set minus K. My key 1 minus B min 1 minus B val 1. So it inserted one record into the local node. This is just to create test. So in AMC you should see like one object in here. Sorry, I'll paste it in color editing.
Yeah.
This is just insert one record with key, my key 1, bin 1, value 1. We'll do more complex operations. Okay. So if you go back to your public, ANC, it will show that like there is one object inserted into the cluster. Okay. So let's do more complex things. So this is where we have a tool where you can load data, which can generate some fake load, like at different throughputs and stuff like that. You get different types of data. You can simulate your application profile. Yeah, I'll paste and modifying.
Unable to connect this one.
So this inserts 1 million records, this command. Let's use so you can see here, right? I'll copy paste. You can see the TPS here. So the TPS you are seeing is like about like 150,000 transactions. Like 1 million records are inserted. We didn't even time it, so let's just time it again.
7 seconds each of them is an average.
Yes.
So this is insertion of 1 million records, pure writes. It took about 8 seconds. I'll copy paste this command. So this is C3 8XL. So now we inserted all these 1 million records. We can now try to read all of them. So are you here at so W initially I said I, that means just insert. So now read update with a read with a write ratio read ratio of 90.
What is the size of each record?
50 characters. 50 characters. It's a string of 50 bytes.
50 bytes?
So yeah.
Totally 1 million?
Yeah. 50 MB.
50 MB data is written in 8 seconds.
This is pure write. So we'll see the reads.
That was.
Okay. So this command will keep continuously reading the data. I'll just copy it and somebody is changing it. Don't change in the color.
Let me pull it out. I have the statistic.
So this will generate a continuous load of reads and writes, and it shows like what is the TPS that you are getting here. So remember that this is not the saturation of the server, it is the saturation of the client. Okay, so don't, I said like 900,000 transactions per second, but this is generated by single client. If I have more clients, more instances of the clients or more machines generating, the client can absorb all of that. And like when we form clusters of four nodes each, so one guy can run, one person, or we can run the client from all the four instances, and we'll see that.
So this is a silly question. I have now, I seem to have 1,065,000 replicators right now.
Sorry?
I seem to have 1,065,000 replicator objects right now. So it's a
did it stop the load?
Yeah, the Java client has extra because of my
data. No, he said he got only 65 objects total.
A million and 65.
And 65. Oh, okay. So
multiple data sets.
We ran with 64 thread parallelism, so I think so you can see the ANC here. So the reads and writes, the percentage of reads you are seeing is about like 160 or like 150,000 transactions pure reads, and like about 17k writes. So you can see it in your personal ANC. So if you see the different stats here, right, so you can see the replicated objects like little more than a million, and then total number of client connections that are currently active. So the client, the single, because we are doing with 64 parallelism, so we have about 64 threads parallelly connecting to that node, and like one or couple of connections which are discovering the cluster, any state change in the cluster and things like that. So you may see this going up and down. Okay. And so like again, master objects, what is the size RAM occupied? So like about 128 MB is occupied. Sir, it's 128 MB.
Okay.
So anybody has trouble reaching here, where you can run your own load and see it for yourself, how much you can generate?
Yeah?
Okay.
doing this.
So in this workload, right, I just ran with strings, but the tool is capable of generating many different types of data. Okay. If you see the readme, it explains what does each parameter mean. So if you simply do run benchmarks, right, it will give you examples of like, not examples, explanation of what all it means. The keys like. You can take a backup if that's what you want to do. You want to do that?
Actually, what is the structure on the table of the application which is then very smart
people
know the reader or see the structure.
So that's kind of hidden, but so if you do minus E partition info. It dumps a lot of stuff. These are internal details which you generally need not know, but we use this for debugging. So it says like what are the all these partitions, namespace partition, and what is the objects in each partition. So somebody asked like how do you know that it's not imbalanced? So this is your proof. So if you see like everything is around like between 15k to 18k. That's because again like the number of data that we inserted is very less. So if you have more data, the skew will become much, much lesser, right? So this is all the 4K partitions information, each partitions information, how much data went into each partition. Okay? So let's try to form clusters. So pick any four people, like four together. And I think we partner with somebody who is running here. You are running there? Okay. So,
let's form a line. So, this line the cluster.
Up to you. I think like you are just far apart. So, if you want to see that, you can see. I think like four people is good. Or like four or three, like whoever is running or who could log in there.
What's the last command?
Let it run. Oh, once we change the configuration, we have to. Sorry? Yeah, you can stop the load. So the way mesh works, right, because multicast is like a gossip protocol, everybody can talk to anybody. Multicast is slightly different. So you have to say like one node in my cluster is where I will talk to and tell about myself. So once every node goes and tells this node that this is my IP, that node again will share that information with all the nodes. So when I go and talk to this, let's say mesh principal, I'll give my IP to him. So he will say, okay, I already know these three guys that I'm aware of. So it will give me the full list. So I will go and directly talk to these nodes. Okay. So what we have to do here in mesh configuration is to say that whom should I talk to get the full list of the cluster. Okay. So in your group of three, four, five, whatever it is, pick one guy as your leader and use his IP. Okay?
Private IP.
So how do you, like, you can simply do this point space?
Yeah, the command prompt.
Yeah. Oh, sorry. Yeah. Thank you. So the IP will be like 172.31.40.162 in my case. Okay? So this will be your private IP.
Don't use his IP, otherwise everyone will.
Yeah, so don't use my IP. Okay? It will be like a 100 node cluster. So can you tell me your IP? So just a second. So in the mesh address mesh port, right, it is written as like 10.10.10. just to fake something.
Are we going to use the git command?
We can do that, but
you want to restart?
Yeah, just to see how to configure the config file.
So we'll follow you.
So if you go to your config file, right, there is a mesh address written and like it says 10.10.10.10. Okay? So tell me your IP. 172.31.40.11. So I'm picking him as the leader of my cluster. So like which are 4 or 5, 3, 4, 5 node cluster you are forming, you have to pick that leader's IP address and put it in mesh address. Sorry, come down a bit, please. There's a question.
I'm trying to understand what
you're saying. So like whoever is the representative of your whole cluster, you should pick his private IP and just enter against mesh address in the config file. Leader will not do anything. Even if he does this, it's still fine. So even
just
if leader does this,
it's fine.
Yeah. So you'll talk to himself. Okay. So once you, so everybody modified the config files. Sorry. The config file will be etc aerospike aerospike.conf. You see it here?
This is master's address.
Sorry?
This is master's address. Leaders, master's.
Yeah, everyone can do it. Yeah. Anybody can do.
In case of master, it doesn't matter because you are trying to contact yourself, but out here, let's just see a list of master. The way it helps is, for example, the same config file can go. That's the way it is. All calling config files.
Okay, so let's. So once the you can change it. So okay. So let's give a simple rule. Everybody change it to the leader's IP address. Okay? Yes. So once you do that, once you edit the config file, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. So once you edit the conf file, you just have to restart your node. Etc aerospike init.d aerospike restart. Okay. So I'm restarting my.
You don't need to restart. I don't.
It doesn't matter.
AMC.
AMC, you don't need to restart. So that's what I'm going to show. I restarted my node. Just aerospike init D restart. So etc init D aerospike restart. So it takes a little bit of time to come up. Okay. Okay, so here you can see like my nodes are increasing already in my NC to 3 nodes. So I told it will be auto sharding, right? Sorry, auto rebalancing also once you have clusters. So you can see the rebalancing happening here. So my 3 nodes, sorry, can I get your attention? You have a small grid where you can see this information. Okay, so I just added his IP as my leader. So you can see like I found a 3 node cluster, and you can see like the migrates going and incoming and outgoing. So this signifies that the data is getting rebalanced as we are speaking. And, like you can see the object count that will keep changing. It will be refreshed every 5 seconds. And you see the replicated objects, it will again balance out. Doesn't matter.
Just say ETC, Aerospike, restart. Like you started, just say restart.
Okay, so let's do one interesting experiment here. So while the rebalancing is happening, let's do reads and writes. Okay? So I.
Why the RAM is changing a lot?
Sorry?
The RAM is changing a lot.
Because the whole rebalancing is happening, right?
So it's available RAM.
Correct. Both. Total RAM and used RAM. So and when you are a single node, you had only one copy of the data. So now you have two copies of the data. So like it will consume actually 2/3 now because you have 3 nodes. It should rebalance. Like we are seeing the rebalancing happening here. I took down the node. Again, by mistake, I restarted my node. So that means it is down and now it's up. So it will show red if the node is down. Now it's green, it is.
Anyone who is still in a single node cluster, who still hasn't formed multi node cluster?
Okay. So you see this process is very hard, right? So everybody started one instance, then you change this configuration, form clusters, all this stuff. So I'm going to quickly take you through cloud formation that we have. So Amazon has this nice service called cloud formation. Network or disconnect? No, the servers will be running. You just reconnect back to that. You don't. That doesn't. Unless I'm at the point. Yeah.
think the internet is
How many connections the tool is making connections to the
application?
Client connections which includes the browser. Browser will keep talking to the registrar. All of them. Then you must be running the tool. So 64 bit parallel. The one benchmark, somebody might be running in the cluster. They can see the reads and writes happening per node. So somebody is running the node in the cluster. So Amazon has this cloud formation where you can define your entire cluster upfront and you don't need to define it. So Aerospike has a script where you can say like, I want to do this cloud formation. And
what's your cluster?
Maybe you logged in the same machine. Oh, the Wi-Fi IP you are saying.
No, AWS IP is
listen to IP.
Okay. So how to do this cloud formation script, like you just have to say like so you have to pick a template file. So this is the Aerospike cloud formation script. So if you pick this aid, sorry? Okay, let's finish this one, so please.
Okay, people!
Turn the mic on.
No, it's already on. People are dominating me. So, okay, so the cloud formation script, the second stage we have. So basically, it will ask just three questions. What instance type do you want to pick? And what is the key pair which is personal to you? I should say, like, Sunil_US East. So, number of instances I want in my cluster, I can say 4 and simply say next. So it will ask, do you want to add tags and all? So it will just ask me to review, and if I say create, it will form a 4-node cluster. Okay? Of Aerospike. That's it. So you don't need to do any of these steps that we have done now. And like in bare metal machines, if you have your own local LAN running, it will automatically form a cluster using multicast IP. You don't even need to edit, have special configuration for different nodes. So if you are deploying on Amazon, you should be using the cloud formation script to make it easy. If you have bare metal machine, you shouldn't be using mesh. Okay. So this will go on, so I'll not keep track of it.
So we'll quickly go into coding, okay? How to write an application using Aerospike, sorry, Node.js. So I'm picking Node.js as an example. So and the So we have uploaded our Node.js client in NPM repository. So if you have to start using Node.js, all you have to run is one command. So you just have to say npm install Aerospike. Okay.
What is
the
alert from top?
Anytime a new node joins, anything goes down, if there are anything bad things which are happening in the cluster, it will show alerts. And there are different types of red alerts, which node down events. There are some yellow events which need not have immediate attention.
Red alert says cluster integrity has been restored.
I think like because of all this activity, like nodes going in and out, you should be having that problem, I guess. It should restore again, like.
Yeah, because they are, okay, so people who are not using their AMC, maybe they should shut it down, because what will happen is that all of individuals' AMC, right, they'll keep polling the EC2. So it's basically just your normal internet traffic. So even if you are not viewing it, it will continuously keep getting traffic. So let's say in a team, just keep one AMC running and others can just close that tab. That will help them.
Yeah, I think like we are done with the AMC part, so maybe everybody can close their AMC browser. It will generate a lot of traffic, but like with 100 people, it generates a lot of traffic. Okay, so please close this AMC console that is open. I think it is screwing up the internet. Let everybody close the browsers. So I think hopefully the internet will become better.
It's just permission in internet, actually. It's not about internet.
Okay, so I'm also closing my browser. So this is the cloud formation which is completed. So I can simply say delete stack to just dismantle my entire cluster. Okay. I think it is acting up. So we already downloaded node on this box, so your ACT box. So there is a node modules directory. So you already see Aerospike there. So what I can start doing is I can write my Node.js application. Okay. So she's the one who wrote the entire Node.js client. So I'm just acting that I know it. Okay, so all I need to do is let me take help with us. Okay, so maybe we'll do it simple because it is taking time to walk through. So I have the entire very basic thing already written here. I'll walk through the code.
Can you put the command in collaborate?
So I'll just walk you through this thing. So all you have to do is you initially say like require Aerospike, because you already downloaded Aerospike. So you have to tell like what are the parameters, the seed IP. So you can see that in the config. So config has host field which has an array of IP addresses. You can supply an array of IP addresses. One is enough, but that machine should be up and running. So what people do is like they may keep like 4 or 5 IPs. So even if one instance is not running, it will connect to the other IPs and discover the current cluster. Okay. So you see the host and policies, like what should be the timeout when it is attempting. So if you are doing a get or a put, so how much time the client should wait. So if you say 0, it will wait indefinitely. But here I'm just giving a timeout of 0. Okay. So once you do this, you have to say like aerospike.client.connect and say like what you want to do on connect. Okay. So here you have to give a function, what is the behavior once this job is done. So connect job is done. So I'm not doing anything here. Whatever is coming out of error and client, I'm just dumping to my console. Okay. So now we just talk what is the data model. So it is a key with a set of bins, right? So you have to define your key. So yes, and like this is a JSON structure or JavaScript object, talking simple terms. So it needs to have 3 fields: namespace, set, and key. So what is the namespace? Test. Set is my set, and like the key I want to put is my key. Okay. So this is my key, and like my record will be. Are 2 bins, in this case 2 bins. Int bin, if you simply say 1, it will automatically detect that it is an integer and it will insert as an integer. So if you put this in quotes, it will become a string. If you give it as an array, it will become a list. If you put it as in a map, it will become a map. Okay? It will be automatically detected, so you don't need to say this is string, this is integer and things like that. So, and like every record will also have some metadata associated with it. This is optional, but you can set a TTL for the record. So if I want to expire in like a day, I can say like for an hour, so I can say 3600. So. Okay. And generation, again, these are optional things. So when I write, I want to write with generation 1. Okay.
And this TTL is for any
You don't need to say that, like I was saying, these are optional parameters. If you don't say a TTL here, it will pick the namespace configuration. We saw, right, default TTL, 30 days, it will pick that.
Okay.
If I want to override with every write, I can do that.
Okay. And this is at the key level? So
sorry? Key level, record level, yeah.
Record level.
Okay, so all I do is like asobject.put. So now I'm specifying my key here, my record, the metadata, and like what is the action that should be taken as a return for that operation when the operation returns. So here I'm not again doing anything, so I'm just dumping everything to the console. Okay. So I have this running. So I hard coded IPs here, which is like my local box. So I just need to do node simple put. Okay.
I think you need to do it after the client is connected, but it's going to do it.
The server? Sorry?
No, you are doing it from your Mac.
Yeah, so this should be running. Yeah. So there are like different callbacks, right? At connect also you have a callback. What is the action that should be taken? And after put also you have a callback.
Yes, I understand. But so would you be able to, this is going to get called back, right? So in a sense, the AS object that put will be called, might be called before the callback gets called, right? Or before a client.
Yeah. So you that's right. So I'll put a sleep now. Simple sleep. What is that?
What is that? You don't have sleep. You have to say set timeout and then call it another.
Okay.
You can have something like that.
This is not C.
You can say request.
It's harder than C.
Okay. Probably I
I can simply run the get. Let me see if I get it at least. These all have time. So if I see my get example is also like simple. So again, I give the same key. I'll simply say get. I don't need to specify metadata and all here. The same standard steps of connecting, and I'm defining my key and simply saying get. Okay. So if we need to go to a little complex example that again written by Gatri. So there's a URL shortener example running here. So it has these different steps where there will be a HTTP server listening. So you can say like, this is my long URL, shorten it for me. It will store it in Aerospike, and it has different counters so that there is no hotspot again. Like we have 1,000 counters running. So every URL that comes like again gets hashed, and like it will pick one of the counter, it will generate the next ID for that, and it will give it back to you. So if you click the URL, the same node server will again redirect automatically to the long URL. So it's like saying the bit.ly thing, like standard stuff that you have. I hope it will connect now. So if I simply say, it is asking me like a URL, right? So let's say I click this whole Google search string. It will say generate short URL. No, I think like it's not connecting to the backend. Okay, unless my IP changed. I guess that's the reason. I hard-coded stuff here. Okay. So it generated this URL. Again, this is stored in Aerospike. Okay. So now if I just copy paste this URL in a different window, the request will hit Node.js. It will go to the correct counter, pick the long URL which is stored as a key. The value will be stored as a long URL. The short URL will be this key that you are seeing here. So it will fetch that, automatically redirect the request, and you see the same Google search that you are seeing. Okay. So now that I know the problem, I can fix this. So never hard code your IPs. Okay, so it says Aerospike okay, and if it fails, right, it gives reasons why it failed or where it failed in the code. So it will tell what is function file line and stuff like that. So it also just for printing sake, it printed what is the namespace key and all that stuff. Okay, this is the callback dump like when it was connecting. This is for the put. So if I simply do a get, it will give me back my key. I didn't fix this part. Okay, so we got back the integer bin and the string bin here. So this is like the return status of the call. Okay. So okay, I demonstrate the URL shortener also. Any questions on the clients? Like how to connect and things like that. So I think like if you pick any of our clients, right, you'll see the same structure. You have a connection stage. Use that object, do get put, you can define your policies. Like I'm not going into all the details, but like the structure will be the same in across all our clients.
You might be trying to lift field with the record. So was it a Radix like use case?
No, like hash. Typically with ad businesses, right, they are not interested in this record after let's say 30 days. That's like too old for them. So like different people have different use cases, and some people want it to live forever, in which case you can simply say TTL equal to 0.
I thought people store data forever.
Yeah, you can store. We are just giving an option. So when you set TTL 30, what happens is system will automatically keep cleaning up this data.
So you don't need to do that yourself if you don't want that data. The system will take care of that.
The use case of a short-lived data is your cookies, right? Or your session. I mean, session keeps changing every time you log in. There's no point in storing that. Cookie data, yes, but just your cookie value.
So, any questions on the client side? Client APIs?
Python one equipped to more.
Yeah, I think like we could do that. Okay, so quickly I'll point you to the so like we do a get put, right? We have a operate so operators. So if you see here, like you can say like var ops, like op dot append, op dot increment, op dot read.
Okay.
So you can do that.
Okay. And this is not like a read update, it's just one automated.
Yeah, it is automated. So operation is like the beauty of operations is the whole set of operations that you do will be under one log. So if you want to update and read it back again, you can do that. So but you shouldn't attempt two writes in the same operation. That's the only restriction. On the same bin, so two different bins obviously you can do that. Okay. So I think then we'll conclude the coding part. So we'll talk about how to tune in general any system on AWS. Sure, we'll do that. So
how many of you use AWS EC2? Have used? Do try. Okay. So like Aerospike, it does 1 million TPS, right? We have been talking about bare metals. That's where we do. Cloud, so how many nodes do you think it will take on a cloud on EC2 provider to do 1 million TPS?
Three nodes.
Three nodes?
That's what he said.
Okay, that's what he said. So one of the things that we do is we always underestimate ourselves when we are telling it to public. So that you are saying three nodes, in reality I can show it to you on one node. So the reason for that is you go into, he said three nodes, it's not working. We know that we'll definitely do that. So yeah, we can do that on one node itself. But the main thing, it's not just about Aerospike. It's basically what we are going to talk about right now is AWS. It's not just Aerospike which can do well on EC2 or AWS. Normally we say virtualization is not a place where you want to do high performance things. It's good to maybe run your Apache. It's good to run your WordPress. But if you really want something which is really, really, really high performance application, I mean, I have always been a bare metal guy. I mean, even at work, people talk about virtualization and I'm like, man, that's not going to work. But so the reason this entire conversation, this entire exercise came up was like, we were closed source earlier and we always supported virtualization techniques, but we never guaranteed performance on those. What we said that, yes, it will work, but yeah, we won't guarantee 98.5% of some millisecond latencies. Because Amazon doesn't provide us guarantee, how can we do? So one of the things was that we did not know how we will perform on Aerospike, on AWS. So what we did was, before anyone else goes, once we became open source and people will try it out, it was like high time we went ahead and tried it out.
So, I mean, earlier I just used to use, you know, AWS, spin up instance, SSH, do this, do blah, 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 shut it down, done. Never tried it from performance point of view. So once we started, first thing was, okay, spin up an instance, SSH, install, and just run Aerospike. The first numbers that we got was 85K TPS. Now, that could be very high when it comes to, you know, rest of the world. But for us, 85K TPS is like, on my Mac, I get some 120, 140K TPS, man. So 85K TPS is nothing. So it was like, okay, what is the bottleneck? And again, because it was benchmark numbers, we started on C3 8X. So that was like, yeah, that was a good machine. There was no bottleneck on it. We looked into it, and what we found was that what was blocking was the network. So when I started, I was using something called the PV image, the paravirtualized image. That is what Amazon was offering, you know, so far by default. Spin up C3 8X PV image, and all it gave us was 85K TPS. We used iPerf also to figure out what was it. Again, same 85K TPS and about 1.86 Gbps, whereas C3 8X is supposed to give us 10 Gbps. So it was simply not working out. A quick search on the net, and yeah, everyone else was getting some 100K, 120K TPS on Amazon. That was simply not going to work for us. So then we looked around a bit more, and we figured out that Amazon also has improved lately. Sometime last year, they came up with something called enhanced networking. And one of the requirements for enhanced networking was HVM. That's hardware virtualized something. You can read up on it.
Hardware assisted virtualization.
So the thing how it works is basically your virtualized machine, it has better / direct access to the underlying hardware. For example, let's say on these machines, on the higher end machines, the network cards that Amazon uses, it actually has queues of the order of basically around 40 queues per card. I mean, you are never going to get access to that many queues on any of the EC2 instances. So, but because it uses HVM, I mean, Amazon still doesn't tell you, but we kind of figured it out, like, yeah, with various stuff. So, okay, let's quickly try it out. So, okay, I'm logging into some machine. Okay. Okay, network died. So the thing that I'm talking about is, so AMC is one of the newer tools that, you know, you can use in a browser, but okay, this is a terminal way of figuring out how many we are doing. So basically what I'm going to do right now is run the same things that we did, you know, inserts or read, and see what kind of numbers we get. Okay, I'm doing reads at about 215, 220, 250K. If we go to AMC again, it will show similar numbers. This we show in 10 second time slices, so that's why the first one came about 199, the second will come on. But okay, the main thing that we are talking about is in terms of TPS. So yeah, by default, HVM, I mean, you don't do anything, each NIC will give you about 250K TPS. We needed 1 million TPS at least on the NIC. So what do we do about it? One way of achieving it, of rather increasing your instance performance, especially on a lesser instances, basically up to, like, say anything .4XL, is use something called RPS, that is received packet steering. So the way it works is basically one of the problems with these instances is, okay. Okay, the resolution won't allow me to put it to 1. Okay. So what happens out here is basically the network is all the packets by default it goes only to the first core. So if you see it in top and you do top 1, it will show you all the 32 cores. C3 8XL has 32 cores. If by default it will all the packets will go only to the first and second cores, and your rest of machine will keep, you know, will just be lying around idle. So how to improve that?
Okay.
Okay, let me quickly disconnect because I can't see because of the low resolution. I'll just get my notes. Sorry about that. So this basically is a system which has RPS enabled. How do we know that? So the default way, so this is what the default configuration for your RPS underscore CPUs is. What it means is no matter like from where, from on which queue you are getting it, send it over to the zeroth processor, zeroth core. So it will only go to the single core. Now what do we want to do? We want it to spread it over to all the cores, all the processors that we have available. So basically it's same. Let's say if you want to spread it over to say the first four cores, so 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4, again in hex becomes F. So that's what we had done out here. So a value of F means that, yeah, send it out to the first four cores. So any packet you send, it will be distributed amongst the first four cores of the system. Again, top is kind of stuck because of the low resolution. Yeah, so terminal is not big enough. Let me see if I can. Okay. So you see this one, right? The network load, this particular thing, soft interrupts, they are being distributed among over four cores right now. So this has happened after we switched the value over to F. If we switch it back to zero, which is the default, so now you see that it's, earlier it was on 4 cores, now it has come down to 2 cores. So this is the default configuration. So basically this is the place where your instance will get bottlenecked. Out here we are using C3 8X large, which has 2 queues per NIC. On lower instances, I guess even on 4XL, 2XL for sure has a single queue. I think even 4XL have single queue. So max that you can do out there is F. What we have figured out, like even on 8XL, the best performance comes out when you are using F. Like if you increase the number of processors, then the, even though RPS by definition is not supposed to increase the hardware interrupts on a bare metal machine, But on this particular, like, yeah, this virtualization layer, what we see is that there's a very, very high increase in hardware interruption. So basically, you're not able to maximize your RPS. That's, so the limit that we found out here is like, okay, without RPS, we can get about 250k TPS on a single NIC. With RPS, it will go about 750-800k TPS. And if you increase it furthermore, then yeah, it will just be stuck. I mean, it will come down because, again, hardware interrupts have increased. So it will come down. But the max that you can get with RPS on this thing is 800k TPS. So how do we achieve 1 million TPS? So the way to do that, like, our bottleneck is each NIC is tied to a core and it goes to that single core. What is the easy way out? Increase the number of NICs. Because you can't increase number of queues on a virtualized layer, what you can do is increase the number of NICs. So AWS has something called ENIs, Elastic Network Interfaces. The good thing about ENIs is, unlike most of the AWS stuff, this is free. You don't pay anything for it. I mean, you use Elastic IPs, you don't pay for it as long as you are using it. But if you don't use it, you pay for it. That's not the case with ENIs. It's no matter whether you just create them and keep them around or you use them, there's no charge for using ENIs. But the only thing is, yeah, there is again limits on how many ENIs you can attach or how many interfaces you can attach to each instance. For 8XLs, you can attach about 8. For 4XL, you can attach 4. For 2XL, 3. So yeah, it's documented. So that is the limit. On 8XL, we ended up, like, when we are trying out, we attach all the 8 NICs, but what we figured out that we needed only four more NICs. Each NIC was giving us about 250k TPS. We attached them, we attached 4, and yeah, we could get 1 million TPS. So I was initially planning to give a demo, but what happened is that, yeah, I ended up creating 107 instances for us in a single zone. How could I do that? So Amazon itself has a limitation of only 20 on demand or 5 spot instances. So thankfully, like, yeah, we ended up calling Amazon, yeah, blah, 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 they increased the limit. But the side effect is I don't have any network ENIs left in that region, so I cannot attach any ENIs right now. I do have in another one, but yeah, we are running short of time as well. So the easy way out to do is, all of you have the C3 8XLs for the time being. Or, okay, I mean, even if you don't have it, you can do it on your own. 1 million TPS for an hour, it's going to cost you $1.68. That's the max for on-demand prices. Go for on-spot prices. That is, for a C3 8XL, you will pay about $0.25 to $0.26. That is about 15 rupees per hour. So that's what you will pay for 1 million TPS. That's for a server. For a client, you will need to spin up, let's say, maybe more clients. You can use smaller instances. You can just use R3.2XLs. So that's enough to push things. So the basic thing is, for any instance types where you are facing this packets restriction, use RPS. If you are using PV for your existing stuff, move over to HVM as soon as possible. Move over to enhanced networking as soon as possible. Amazon itself is pushing towards HVM. So now if you go towards, you know, EC2 console launch instance, earlier it used to be top layers of PV and then you would have to search for HVM images. Now starting 1st April, they have reverted, not 1st April, 1st of July, I guess. Like whenever they launch the T2 micros and all, they have reverted it. So PV instances are completely gone from the default page. Now you have to search for the PV images. HVM images are what are there by default. One caveat about enhanced networking, it's not available on all the existing older generations one. It is available on the latest R3s, C3s, and I2s, I3s. These are the only instance types where enhanced networking is available. M3s, they have HVM instance, but they do not support enhanced networking yet. But as Amazon is gradually moving towards HVM, do expect that support to come. But yeah, you should be using either RC or I to make use of enhanced networking. Another thing quickly about enhanced networking and VPC, there's something called placement groups. When you use, okay, let me quickly talk about what are the requirements for enhanced networking. You should be using HVM. That's the topmost requirement. Another requirement, so the requirement for HVM is you should be using VPC. You can only launch HVM instance only in VPC. You cannot launch it in EC2 Classic. So starting 1st of January 2014, Amazon has, like, if you created your account after 1st Jan 2014, your account will only have VPC option. You will not have the EC2 Classic option. Earlier there used to be EC2 Classic option. So older accounts will still have that option. You can go into VPC and then create, but yeah. So VPC and HVM is the prerequisite for enhanced networking. Another thing which is there but not widely talked about, or it is documented but not many people know about it or use it, is something called the placement groups. So what does placement group mean? Placement group just means that, okay, your instances will be clubbed together. Fine. What does it mean to me? I mean, how? Why do I care? Why it matters or why do you care is because in Amazon, even though it doesn't tell you explicitly, it is documented about the, in their placement groups. What happens in a placement group is you are placed in a specific 10G network. So even though you might still be on an RC2XL or RC4XL, what you will get is a 10G network. You won't get the entire bandwidth, but what will happen is your quality of your network will improve. So that's what happened with us. Like, we initially we were using RC2XL for our benchmarks and we were getting about 1.86 Gbps and we were like, wow. We came back to it and we didn't use placement group and it came down to 1 Gbps. So we were like, what happened? So that's when we figured out. Use placement groups always. Again, like in case of Amazon, it's not guaranteed that you'll always get good performance. Okay, I'm gonna take another 5 minutes, less than 5 minutes to wrap up. I'm being hinted, so yeah. HVM, enhanced networking, placement groups. I guess, yeah, that's pretty much it. So, do you guys have any performance questions about EC2? What all you have been doing? You have faced any problems about it? I mean, yeah. Or any other questions what we have talked about so far? Yes, but right now it's only in a single instance. I'll distribute it across the instance. So this particular instance was in East. Just search for Aerospike, so you will find couple of AMIs. This one is called Aerospike 5th Elephant Workshop. I mean, this I'll distribute it across regions. I'll do it later today. So the way you should actually be doing it is you should go to AWS Marketplace. Because that is the place, this one was created just for the purpose of workshop, so we put the latest stuff out there. This will definitely not be updated. AWS Marketplace is the place where we keep updating all the time. And again, Aerospike, that's a free edition. You don't pay for Aerospike, only thing you'll pay for is the instance charges. So you should be using AWS Marketplace.
Do you use any type of storage
with this? Again, we support, but we have not benchmarked it yet. We so far what we have benchmarked is the in-memory thing, but we are working upon it.
So question, I'm not totally correct, but like, have you compared AWS with
other cloud providers?
Yeah.
Yeah. So we have. I mean, we are in the process right now. Expect a blog soon enough about performance on EC2. Right now, we are in the process of comparing it with Google Compute Engine. That's the next cloud provider. Other cloud providers, I mean, we have some comparisons with, say, bare metal providers as well. So yeah, there are a couple of comparisons out there. Okay, so I guess I'm being told very gently to get out of the room, but yes, we are available outside. I mean, you have any questions, feel free to reach out or you can mail me anshu@aerospike.com.
You will also be in the conference tomorrow.
Yeah, I'll be there tomorrow. So yeah, feel free to reach out to us over there.